the common story in people with problems is I took some ibuprofen, I took some voltaren. We have, like, we say it every year, like you say, it's number one. They are a risk factor for exercise-associated hyponatremia, which I can talk about later, that can make people super sick. Risk factor for kidney damage and muscle breakdown, rhabdomyolysis. Really serious things that can land you in hospital. And it's also like, it'll potentially, you don't need one of those life-threatening things to ruin your race.
Kia ora tato, that was Dr. Tom Reynolds. I'm Matt Raymond.
And I'm Eugene Bingham.
And this is Dirt Church Radio. Interesting conversations with interesting runners. New year.
Yes. You know what that means.
Same us.
Yeah. But you know what it means.
Same wild things.
Yeah, but you know what it means.
New wild things code.
Yeah, and this is going to be quite hard to explain because the old code was DCR 2020.
That's okay. The old code.
That's the old code. Don't use that.
I had to email Mel about four times about this.
The new code. Mm-hmm. Do you know what it is? You got a pen?
Yeah.
DCR 2021.
Do that again.
DCR 2021. I'm not quite sure how they've figured it out, but that's the code that you use. So you can use it to get 15 months VIP membership of Wild Things for the price of 12.
Yes.
Plus they give us a little bit of...
They do. It's a bit of a scratch and tickle.
You're happy because you get the Wild Things VIP membership.
You get access to their store, which is actually really good and actually has really good discounts on lots of really good stuff.
Lots of really good products. Yep. They're happy because they get an extra VIP member, and we're happy because we get a bit of...
Yeah, from Mel and Sal. So if you go to the website, which is...
wildthings.club.
And enter the code DCR2021... Yeah, you get 15 months for the price of 12. You're in the money for new year, new you, same us.
Yeah, DCR 2021. Don't forget it. It's quite hard to remember.
Speaking of new things, I'm still treating as new the Kinabalu Ultra RC from Scott Running that I ran Kepler in.
Yes.
And came out of that, well, I was going to say scot-free. But I fell over and really hurt myself. But that was my fault, not the shoes. But they're still going strong as after a summer of quite hectic use. The Kinabalu Ultra RC from Scott Running is a fantastic shoe. And if you go to scottrunning.nz, because he's got new stock because the boat came in.
Fantastic. The boat came in,
or however it got here. I'm not sure if it was either a boat or an airplane, but it got here.
Pigeon drop?
We need a lot of pigeons.
Mm-hmm. But they're here.
They're here. You go to Scott Running.
Tearing up trails near you.
.nz.
Mm. Further Faster.
What do you say about Further Faster?
Well.
Did you hear that Rocky from Further Faster got accused of being in a gang?
Yeah, he did.
Yeah.
He did.
Maybe it's due to the fact that he walks around like an extra from Sons of Anarchy, really. He's got the mullet, and the beard, and the bandana. Yeah.
And then what really set it off?
Was the fetching new Dirt Church Radio t-shirts with the panther, the vigilance panther on the back.
Yeah.
Accused of being in a gang, but the only gang he is in is, I guess he'd be in the Montane gang. Dirt Church gang.
The Dirt Church gang. It's a cool gang.
It's a cool gang. Yeah. DCR, that's right. Anyway, so if you go to furtherfaster.co.nz, which is the best independently owned outdoors retailer in the country, you can check out all the amazing stuff that they've got. Montane gear, they've got kayaks, they've got... Do you know what I really want for 2021? My new resolution?
No.
The jet boil.
What's that?
You go and find out.
All right.
I want a jet boil.
Which website do I go to?
And just type in jet boil, but furtherfaster.co.nz would be the one that you'd go to for a jet boil.
All right.
I don't have a jet boil. I'm not angling for a jet boil. I just really want one.
You know what I've been thrashing? It's my little cup thing.
Yes. I use it every day. Every day. So we use the Life Adventure. Yeah. Life Adventure keep cups, thermos, and... They keep things hot, but they keep things very cold too. And it's been useful in this weather, so we should probably play the jingle and let the people get on with the podcast.
It goes something like further, faster, there in Christchurch. Rocky is hairy and so is Badger. Jules is nice and Jacob is delicious. Go further, faster now.
Oh, further, faster, there in Christchurch. Rocky is hairy and so is Badger. Jules is nice and Jacob is delicious. Go further, faster now.
Church Radio.
How's everyone feeling?
Episode 126.
We made it.
We did.
And I mean that generally.
Yeah.
But I also mean that in the current, with the gestalt, the zeitgeist of universal tape of madness that's setting in around.
Well, there is a whole bunch of races coming up, aren't there?
The racing season.
And when you look at those Facebook pages.
Yeah, it's getting good. Yeah, it's getting good. Yeah. And it's good to be back with you, brother. It seems
panic buying of shorts going on as well.
Oh, in our circles.
Yeah.
It's 2021. We're still talking about branch chain amino acids.
I know.
Yeah.
I know.
But anyway, it's good to be back into it.
It is.
It's good to be back with you. And it seems like a long. Suzanne said when I walked out, it seems weird that it was just a week.
There's a lot going on.
But
yeah. Yeah, it certainly does. It's that weird kind of year, isn't it? Everyone's sort of getting back into work mode, but there's still lots of summer to be had and lots of racing going on and stuff. So, funny old time of the year. Hey, thanks for all the feedback about last week.
Yeah, how good was it to catch up with Sarah Douglas?
Yeah.
And great that everyone enjoyed it. And thanks for your kind feedback about us being back. That was that was really lovely.
We missed you too.
Yeah, we missed you too.
Yeah.
And we even had someone say, I have been cheating on other podcasts and... Did you see she actually wrote into, she posted up on her Instagram.
No, what happened?
Well, she said that she'd been enjoying My Dad Wrote a Porno.
Ah, right.
Not to name check. I've never heard. Apparently it's very good, but
I listened to a few episodes. I can't remember why I stopped listening. I didn't stop listening for it, you know, thing, but it was clever.
Yeah.
It was clever. Yeah, maybe we could do a spin-off.
Let's just stick with Troll Runner Nation. Running. But anyway, out there in the forest.
Yeah, I was out there yesterday. It was like Queen Street. Well, you know, like Queen Street used to be.
So busy.
But it was real busy. It was good to see everyone out there. It wasn't just runners too. It was mountain bikers and gravel bikes as well. Lots of gravel bikes around at the moment. But it was good to see everyone sort of finishing off their last few big runs before events like Tarawera this weekend. And I know there's talk about next weekend as well. And are you doing any Tarawera training, Matt?
Well, I'm doing some. I am training, so I'm building back up with my coach. And I did see, I went out for a run yesterday, saw a bunch of people, looking like they're training for the Tarawera. And I also saw one of the dudes, he's usually one of the lead single speed guys who leads in the 100K runner, flew up Barlow Road past me.
Really?
One speed, just going so elegant. But yeah, I've been doing my vocal warm ups.
Yes.
And, hot honey and lemon drinks because I am lucky enough to be one of the MC team in this year's Tarawera Ultra Marathon. So I'll be at the finish line and goodness knows where elsewhere with Paul Chartres, Ali Pottinger, Kerry Suter. How surreal is that?
Yeah.
So can't wait to see you all down there.
Yeah.
And you're going to be down there too.
Yeah, well, I couldn't do the MCing because I'm out going to be running.
I know that he was their first choice.
No. I think it's going to be a tag team thing.
True.
But I'm going to be down there pacing Gene, who paced me last year. So I'm really looking forward to getting down there. I know that Gene and Smudge and everyone else is going down, Saywan and everyone, Harry and Billy and everyone that we know, Tom and... Tom,
and all of you who write into it, there's a huge interest this year.
Yeah,
going to be a party. So.
Yeah, and so we're looking forward to seeing everyone down there. It should be a fun weekend. We're looking forward to it.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
In other news, the annual and it's germane to what we're going to talk about tonight with Dr. Tom Reynolds. The annual, I saw it today for the first time. It's like the new buds of spring or whatever. It's the annual Will It Won't It Rain at Tarawera Facebook post's gone up and everyone's gone apeshit. Portents have been examined.
Yeah.
The augers have been augers. You know, we're 3 weeks out, people.
Yeah.
And we know we've both been there multiple times. We know.
Calm the farm.
Honestly, people. Chill. Yep. Prepare for the worst.
Don't look at the weather forecast just yet.
No.
Because what difference is it going to make?
Exactly.
I mean, you're still going to have your jacket there.
Yeah. Yeah. Reason I'm happy is I use it as a seasonal marker, like an almanac. So I know that when I see, the Will It Won't It Rain Facebook thing, I need to get my potatoes in. So
yeah.
I'm happy.
Yeah, that's right. It means the broccoli's ready. No, no. Anyway, that fell flat.
On to this week's guest.
Yeah. He's got much more sensible things to say.
Absolutely.
So, a bit of a different chat. Usually we come prepared with a bunch of questions. Oh, well, that's a lie. But this time our plan was, okay, Doc, take it away. So it's Dr. Tom Reynolds, who he's one of the medical directors for Tarawera.
Yep.
And he's an adventure racer himself.
Yep.
He's been involved with a bunch of races in both as a competitor but also as medical director.
Absolutely.
I spoke to him last year as part of a story and I thought, hey, he's got some interesting stuff to say that's of interest to trail runners, all endurance athletes really, and let's get him in front of our listeners. And he agreed to, and so, yeah, heaps to listen to and learn with Dr. Tom coming up.
Absolutely. Use this as a tool. Like I said, think of it as a comforter, a Lemsip to soothe your troubled psyche in this time of taper madness.
Namaste.
Namaste, yeah. In one of our Dirt Church Radio shirts.
Oh, yeah.
Whilst you can, because they're calming. Are selling out.
Yeah.
The Vigilance Panther. Yeah. The shirts are selling out. Get in quick if you want one of them. They're delicious. We're even thinking about re-upping because they are doing so well. And what we'll do is if you fire us a detail at dirtchurchmerch@gmail.com, that's dirtchurchmerch@gmail.com, we will get back to you.
And you can have a look at them on the website too.
Absolutely. Our friend Freya at Legom Designs, bringing home the bacon, modelled by the Revenant Czar Ian Evans.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes. Quite a few of them down there, I saw, actually. Yeah. How have you been, man?
Yeah, it's weird. It always seems like the first couple of weeks of the year I struggle to get back into the flow of running. And, you know, time of season, kids, school, work, all that sort of stuff. And it's weird this time being coached, so keeping up with the coaching, that's been really useful. But I have kind of struggled with getting my head in the game. Yesterday, for whatever reason, everything just lifted. I mean, I talked last week, we'd had a bereavement in the family. Mm. We had the funeral on the Friday, and the Saturday was pretty much a write-off. So 26K yesterday, it just what felt like a forever pace with no concern. And I had Dave Brubeck's Take Five stuck in my head, which was the song that was the person wanted played at the funeral. So, I mean, it was just one of those really special runs. And hopefully that's a sign of thing to come. So
yeah.
Pretty good week from a pretty bad week. So
yeah. I hope the whānau's okay.
Yeah, they're good, man. And how about you?
Yeah, good. Sort of getting on with things. Running wise, I had an easy week, which is kind of weird, but it felt good.
You never take easy weeks.
I know. Well, I kind of did in the Tarawera build up last year. I built in every 4 to 6 weeks, just reducing the mileage a bit and having an easier week. But this time, I was taking an easy week, and a few people were messaging me going, "Are you injured? Are you something
okay?
Wrong?
Yeah.
Are you okay?" And the answer was, "Yeah, I'm fine. I'm just doing what coach said." So, taking an easy week, but back into it this week, and really looking forward to getting into that. That's the good thing about those easier weeks. You feel recharged and
that's
ready
right.
to go. So I'm raring to go.
Fantastic. Tell you what keeps us raring to go, it's our Patreon patrons. And if you'd like to support what we do, we'd love you to come on board. If you set up a regular donation, even for the cost of a cup of coffee a month, it'd help us to do things that are a bit outside our reach at the moment, like buying audio equipment to improve our sound quality, and getting some more races to interview people like Tarawera. It would also help us keep the lights on, helping us cover costs like website domains and calls. So for the cost of a one-off koha, a cup of coffee, or a small regular donation at patreon.com/dirtchurchradio. Yeah, we'd love to have you on board. And if that's not absolutely in your wheelhouse at the moment, that's just fine too. We're stoked to be here.
Yeah. Cool. See, I managed to hit the right button this
you
week.
You did.
Yeah.
The biggie.
The biggie.
The third iteration. Toru. Three.
And big written in capital letters too.
B-I-G.
So yeah, this past weekend was the third running of the Revenant. So that's 190 million kilometres and 16 gazillion metres of vert. Four loop course that you have 60 hours to complete.
Yep.
Remember, first year, how many finishes?
None.
Last year?
Three.
And then this year,
Ian Evans.
Oh no,
Ian. Yeah, Evans.
Yeah. So Championi.
Yeah. Yeah. So Ian Evans got timed out last year on the third loop. So
yeah.
He was heading on to his fourth loop and he got timed out. And he didn't miss it by very much and he was gutted. He led from the get-go and after 36 hours, he was the last one still going. He was the only one to complete lap three, which took 41 hours, 4 hours under the cutoff. So, I mean, that's huge. That's that's well
gave
on track.
That, gave him that window, didn't it?
He headed off for his final lap after dealing with searing heat and a night of rain and cold, but he just took it all in his stride. And, you know, he had his dog, Poppy, and his fiancée, Jane, with him.
Yeah.
In spirit, not there with him.
No, that they were there.
Yeah, they were there. They
were not in the
running
whole
race.
Yeah. But there was the Revenant team were great at uploading videos and updates. And I know that I was and tons of you were as well, just constantly refreshing and updating and getting those updates. And it was great to see Ian because he's kind of felt like the almost there guy.
Absolutely.
So many times at Relapse and at Revenant and this was his year. And when he set out on that fourth lap on his own, it was like, man, this is going to be real hard, but you got it.
Yep.
And sure enough, he did. One of my colleagues from Stuff, Mike White, he was down there and we were talking about today and he said, yeah, you know, Ian's just the nicest guy. And the last couple of years have been heartbreaking for him, especially last year when he, you know, he couldn't find that last checkpoint on lap three and missed the cutoff, as you said. And this year, Mike said that Ian just seemed so in control the whole way through. And it was incredibly hot on Friday and Saturday and he found lap three tough. But, you know, that's him, isn't it? He smashed through it. And it was mainly a solo effort. He was out on his own from early on lap two when Michael Stewart, who was running with, his ITB played up and he pulled out. So, you know, man.
40 hours, 135K solo. And that's the thing. This is a, I don't even call it a race. This is an experience where so many people team up.
Yep.
You know, and it takes a special kind of sort of individual. Even, you know, last year, think about the two gentlemen who finished and then Sean who finished. Sean was running with Tom at the start as well. So,
yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
God, it's... incredible.
Yeah, Chris Taylor was second to last on the course. He finally tapped out at checkpoint 11 on lap three. Katie Wright and Jane Beaumont, they made the 30-hour cutoff for two laps, but they decided to stop there. They'd made what the race officials called a slight navigation error, which Katie called the biggest understatement ever.
Yeah.
But, you know, congratulations to Ian. We are so, so happy for you. You've had a lot to do with him at Relapse over the years.
Look, I've been lucky enough to have got to hang out with Ian both times, the Bigs and Relapse last couple of years. And, you know, what you see is what you get. He is stunningly even and just indefatigable. And even in great pain and distress, you know, when his stomach went at Relapse and he's just cheerful. He's a fantastic human being. So I'm so happy for him. Well done, bro.
Well done. I wonder if he had a special boil thing.
His jet boil.
Yeah.
That's where I learned about jet boils and Rebecca learned about jet boils too. When he asked us to turn on his jet boil and we're like, what's a jet boil? After he ran off, we're like, yeah, sure, we'll do that for you because we're tough and cool. And then we're like, what's a jet boil?
Well done. That man.
So right. Going from 190 kilometres to a...
190 million.
190 million kilometres to a respectable 21 kilometres, the classic. Absolutely. So this is the Good Home Taranaki off-road half, and that looked heaps of fun and super stunning.
Yeah.
So in first place for the women was Hannah Gumbly, New Plymouth, 203.24. Sarah Revel Dinent in second in 209.02. And third was Maddie Glazeby of Gisborne in 211.57.
And in the men's, Michael Erb, Taranaki, 132.41, hometown heroes.
Yeah, both absolutely. Of them,
yeah. Kyle Bridgman, 133.41, and Fabian Downs, 135.23, representing Takapuna there.
Takapuna, so, absolutely. The owner.
Hey, tell you who else is smashing it.
And a nurse.
Yes.
Smashing it.
Yes, indeed.
Brooke Thomas.
Mm.
And Adam Keane has been... just fierce spamming the Dirt Church Instagram stories.
And rightly so.
And rightly so.
Yep.
Brooke is smashing it on the 3,000-kilometre Te Araroa Trail. She's fundraising for Heart Kids. She was a competitor, if you don't know, she was a competitive rower for New Zealand, but she was diagnosed with a heart condition, which meant that she had to have a pacemaker installed. as we said, she's a nurse and she's well on track to chase down the FKT on the trail. Mm. Lucy Clark had that 66-day trip last year, but Brooke is already on the home straight.
So. So she was in Queenstown over the weekend, and we'll put the tracker in our show notes, and you can see where she is. But man, you get in quick because she hasn't got long to go.
No, she's about 300k left.
Yeah, she's
we're recording this
on Monday, and I, you know, she was well past Queenstown. Yeah, heading south. So go, Brooke. Awesome. All right.
Greatest run ever, which is the part of the show where we ask you to write into us and tell us your greatest run ever. It doesn't have to be that time that you won the Revenant.
Or set an FKT on the Te Araroa Trail.
It could just be that time that you ran around the block, something that sung to you for some reason. Send it in to us at dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. And this is from Claire Whittle. After much deliberation, I've narrowed it down to the Taupo 100-kilometre ultra. I took part in 2019 and many elements made it special for me. It wasn't my first 100 kilometres, but my first for a number of years. I'm originally from the UK, where I've been a regular runner for upwards of 5 years before heading to New Zealand in 2018. New Zealand reignited my passion for trails, and after running the Auckland Marathon in 2018, in celebration of my permanent move to the country, I got gradually exploring more trails and finding like-minded individuals to share them with. One of the things that I value most about trail running is the camaraderie and strength of spirit, the shared sense of why and the celebration of thrills and spills. I often liken a long run to kind of speed dating friendship experience. Although you're not wrong. All of a sudden you can find yourself spilling your darkest or most intimate secrets to an almost complete stranger. After the run, you decide whether you'll ever see each other again, and often when you do, it makes for some of the closest friendships. I'd got to know a small group of other runners originally through a running chat group for those running at Taupo. Through the group, we shared tips, tricks, encouragement, nerves, and a great deal of banter. Many people I had met in person through self-organized training runs, but some I knew by name only. As I came to New Zealand not knowing a soul, it felt extra special to hang out with these people at the registration and on the course, sharing the experience. From the outset, Taupo was a little daunting. I got told off for the lightness of my lightweight jacket during the kit check. That must be a lightweight, lightweight jacket. Ooh. The woman in charge of checking informed me that it was going to take a very long time and that I would be... It would be a very long time and I would be very dark and cold by the time I finished. Nothing like a little pep talk. Nonetheless, she cleared me to start, stamped my hand and sent me off to be weighed in. My goal was to finish in daylight if possible, between 14 and 15 hours. The race briefing itself was thankfully succinct, and then myself and my wonderful partner, support crew of one extraordinaire, were off for a pre-race pizza and an early night. The day itself started with a rude awakening at 3:15 a.m. and those are the rudest of awakenings, aren't they? Not a favourite time of mine to be awake. However, with a giant bowl of porridge to consume, coffee to drink, manic rechecking of kit and a 1 hour drive to the start, needs must. The race started in the dark with 130 competitors lining up for the 100 kilometres. In total, over 1,000 people took part over distances ranging from 21k to 100 kilometres. The first quarter of the race was on the western shores of Lake Taupo through twisty and turning trails. I was pleased that I'd chosen to wear trail shoes for this part. It was slow going with a frustrating chain of runners winding their way through the single track bush. By 25 kilometres, my hips were aching and I realised that too much of my training had been on the road and relatively flat ones at that. A good race should always teach you a thing or two. At 44 kilometres, I changed from trail shoes to road shoes to tackle the next section of tar sealed road and farmland. It was a real relief to make the switch and I stuck with road shoes for the rest of the run. Next up, there's more farmland before an out-and-back loop at Kinloch took us through woodland and a tiny bit of suburbia. Finally came the K2K and W2K trails to the finish line, altogether a great mix and more than enough to keep you on your toes. There are a few bits about my previous ultra-running experiences that I'd conveniently forgotten. Fact number one, when it's over, I get sick. This has never happened so far during an event in the same way some people experience. I seem to tolerate food all kinds well during the race. This lasts until approximately 30 minutes afterwards. It's like my body is sending me a message saying, since you keep ignoring me, I'm going to make you listen. Anyway, long story short, I crossed the finish line, weighed in, made it to the motel, straight to the shower, which by a stroke of luck hit, had a disabled shower with a seat installed, showered, threw up, ate some popcorn, threw up, ate some more instant noodles, lay down completely flat, and then passed out. Magic. All of the people I knew involved at Top were set out to complete our individual challenges, and frankly, we all nailed it. I finished in daylight, which made me very happy. I ran the vast majority of the course, and I ran it my own way. I got talking to other runners at different points, but ran using my own judgment. Mentally, I felt strong. My fitness and muscles felt good, and I can honestly say that during this run, I did not have a why, never again moment. My partner paced me for a portion of the run, and then again to the finish. As an avid non-runner until about 6 months previously, this meant a huge amount, and I was proud of us both. Post Taupo, I now run weekly health sessions with a runner who had become a firm friend thanks to the Taupo 100. I've gone on a run with many of the originals and still growing up, and the still growing group now dubbed Ultras Anonymous. More running buddies means more exposure to even better endeavors. I wouldn't change a thing.
Wonderful, Claire. Thank you.
Bam!
That leads straight into, really, our conversation with Tom Reynolds, isn't it?
Straight
into.
But
also, quickly, I love that idea of speed dating.
Absolutely.
It is. Yep. It's true. It's true. Yep. It's true. Yeah. 100%. That's what runs are. Thank you, Claire. That's wonderful. Look, as I said, it leads directly into our conversation with Dr. Tom Reynolds. He is an endurance athlete himself. He's raced at world championships for adventure racing, orienteering and mountain biking, and he's reached the podium at numerous trail races. He's also a medical doctor. He was about to head off for a night shift in the emergency ward when we spoke to him, and he's a medical director at Tarawera, Taupo, and a number of other endurance events. He's got a love for this sport that we all do, and we invited him on to give us some tips for runners as we head into this busy race season. And boy, it's a great conversation. Without further ado, Dr. Tom Reynolds.
Digit Radio.
Okay, on the line we have endurance athlete, member of the community, medical doctor, and the medical director for the Tarawera Ultra Marathon, Dr. Tom Reynolds. Tom, kia ora and welcome to Dirt Church Radio.
Kia ora, guys. Thanks for having me.
Oh, it's our absolute pleasure. I think it's time that we act as a Lemsip and a soothing duvet to all the frayed nerves of the people out there who are freaking out about whatever big race they're doing this year, and lay down some kind of sound general advice for people who might be like freaking out about their first ultra marathon. What do you reckon?
I'm sure we can come up with some simple rules, maybe some things that might help people.
That's right. I mean, not to get too specific about things, but look, I walking back that preamble. Look, thanks for coming on Dirt Church Radio, man. We're so pleased to have you on.
Yeah. It's great. I've listened a couple of times to a few different people, and I'm just stoked to be able to share some of this information and just contribute to the discussion.
Brilliant. Brilliant. Look, one of the main things we wanted to, as well as your own sporting background, which we want to talk to you about as well, but we wanted you to talk us through the ways that runners should be prepared to look after themselves and navigate through an endurance event, look out for each other as well. And you've got a list of five things that I think they came from Tarawera, maybe, or you can correct me on that, but they actually apply to all races and not just ultra distances. People who are entering endurance events should be mindful of these things. So do you mind starting off by sort of walking us through those five key things to remember?
Sure. So these five rules are kind of a way to, like, an aid memoir, really. So working across a whole bunch of different ultras, Tarawera included, Taupo Ultra, and some other triathlon-based events, we saw kind of a common set of errors that athletes were making that were making them end up with us. So the intent with these is not to be a scientifically correct, detailed deep dive, but rather just five things you can do. You can run through your checklist a month out, a week out, and make sure you've got a plan. So the first one, and this is definitely for all endurance sport, is say no to non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. So this is a group of medicines that includes things like ibuprofen, diclofenac, Voltaren, Nurofen, naproxen. Basically, the reason to avoid them is that they're a really common theme in a whole bunch of problems that people run into. To cut a long story short, they basically block a whole heap of our body's normal regulatory mechanisms, be that in the kidneys, in the gut, even in muscle and soft tissue healing. So they're a surefire way to start messing with your body and making it hard for it to compensate from the effort that it's doing in an endurance event.
So with the non-steroidals, and I'm curious most about sort of the kidney issues that people can have. Mm-hmm. And so correct, this is the way that I kind of conceptualize it. Is it something to do with because they block or they try to stop inflammation? Is that how it blocks the kind of the more output that the kidney's putting in to manage that inflammatory process? Is that how that works?
Yeah, so it's kind of part of it. So non-steroidals affect a big group of messaging chemicals in our body. Some of those messages are used to carry out inflammatory processes. So that would be like a tendinopathy or a sprain. It's hurt, it's swollen. That's because those messengers are active, and a non-steroidal blocks that, so it stops hurting, stops being swollen.
Right.
But our body's really good at using messengers for multiple jobs, and those same chemicals or chemicals made by very similar enzymes are also really important in regulating and balancing the blood flow in our kidney, and also tied up in trying to match supply and demand, I guess you could say, in terms of the filtration process in the kidney. Mm. So that's the kidney example. Same in the gut. Those chemicals are present in the wall of the gut. So if you're blocking their usual process and turnover, then your gut doesn't work the way it normally does. And this all in a race, this is a time where we need our body to be working tip-top, the normal things to be working. Basically, in ultra, the way you kind of see this in people as they go longer and longer in these races, our body's constantly battling to keep all of our electrolytes, our body temperature, our blood pressure, trying to keep them regular. So we've got all these little clever little reflexes and mechanisms to do that. But as you get more tired and fatigued, the lurches and those regulatory mechanisms get bigger and bigger. So sometimes you might be really hot and then you might be really cold and your body kind of loses its ability to regulate. If we're then taking out additional mechanisms with medicines, then we're kind of not doing our body any favours. Does that kind of make sense?
Absolutely.
Like, yeah, it does.
Because so what you're doing is you're trying to maintain that sort of that term, that homeostasis, aren't you? And I think about the, you know, in terms of the gut, one of the biggest challenges, and I can only sort of think back to my own experience, was learning how to eat and run at the same time, or eat throughout that process. You know, you train your body to take on board, and you need everything to be kind of, I mean, we're a tube essentially, aren't we? to be working, you know, going in the tube and then passing through different tubes and out another tube. So if you're blocking any number of those highways or byways or red flags with that sort of, because it's analgesia, isn't it? So you're stopping feeling it, you can actually be doing other things in the background.
Yeah. So it's I know lots of people will think, oh, well, maybe is it because I'm going to mask pain and do more damage? Maybe, but actually it's the influence on homeostasis other parts of the body that we can't see operating, that just do their thing automatically. I actually really like the homeostasis like concept when you are thinking about your body during a race, because our bodies aren't like flat line all the time. It's like a sine wave. It's like oscillating to, like, our temperature will go up a little and then it'll go down a little, but it'll just oscillate a little bit around a kind of baseline, because we're not a machine. We're like a complicated, like, very complicated biological organism. And so if you are eating, for example, you're adding in food, your body's then got to say, whoa, okay, so I'm sending this amount of blood to my gut, but my muscles need lots, and now I've got food, and it will oscillate back the other way and send a bit more blood to the gut, and then, hold on, I'm getting more demand from the muscles. And so it's this constant kind of catch-up game that we're playing. So that, I think, reflects, and I'm sure you guys would have experienced this in races as well, we have good times and we have bad times. You can be in trouble one moment. You've got your normal, like, things you can do to try and get yourself out of it. But almost inevitably, you'll start to feel better soon. And that's that body just slowly moving in and out of slightly different states around a goal kind of baseline.
And so in terms of those drugs and the fact that they have that impact, I mean, this is really serious, isn't it? This is not just, hey guys, try not to take those. This is like, I've heard Paul Charteris, I think, threaten to throw people out of his race if he takes these things. Like, this is, it's important, this one, isn't it? And that's why you've got it as number one.
That's right. Yeah. It's, they're like the common story in people with problems is I took some ibuprofen. I took some Voltaren.
Yeah.
We have like, we say it every year, like you say, it's number one. They are a risk factor for exercise associated hyponatremia, which I can talk about later, that can make people super sick. Risk factor for kidney damage and muscle breakdown, rhabdomyolysis. Really serious things that can then land you in hospital. And it's also like, it'll potentially, you don't need one of those life-threatening things to ruin your race.
Yeah. So yeah,
it's, I just don't do it. If you need an alternative, if you think, oh, I need this for the race, I think the first question to ask yourself is, okay, is racing the right thing for me to be doing?
Yeah.
I need to be there to fight another day. This is a long game. Sure, I might have to miss this race, but I'll come back stronger. If the answer is, oh, actually, it's just a little niggle or I get a bit sore and, hey, I'll own up, I use paracetamol in some of my races, but that is a far safer option to use.
Right. So paracetamol. Okay.
Yeah. But as, and let's be very clear because we...
Let's not dose up on paracetamol.
Let's not give ourselves a staggered overdose because people don't understand that as well, right? So we're talking sort of a gram or two tablets every 4 to 6 hours as directed.
Yeah, read the box. Don't
read
go
the
over.
Box.
Paracetamol can make you sick too. So it's something which is like a last resort. I think that before reaching for the tablets in a race, you should have other tools in your arsenal to help get you out of that rough spot.
Including pulling out if you have to.
Yeah.
Or not starting.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
I think it's always good to kind of have thought about those, not just a plan B, but a plan C, D, E, F.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Like have thought, what if this, what if that? Lots of long runs, lots of training. You've got lots of time to think about these things. And while we shouldn't plan to fail, it's always good to have thought about it so you can respond to it if it does happen.
Yeah.
Well, I guess it puts it in that place, doesn't it? It's an important part of our life. But, I mean, if you said to someone, hey, would you prefer an ongoing cardiac issue because you had, you know, hyponatremia or, you know, like a rhabdo, the after, you know, the recovery from that, the trauma of going through a serious medical event versus the fact that you didn't get your you didn't get your Kepler medal this year, but then you could keep running through summer and train next year.
Totally. And we've got a busy calendar. We've got, I'm sure everyone would rather be able to do another ultra than be seriously damaged from something. So definitely rule one, say no to non-steroidals.
Now, can I clarify as well, that includes topical preparations?
Well, that is an interesting question.
Not that I'm advocating for them, but I just want to get...
Yeah, they don't have the same... It's not understood. There's just not the literature around
them. Right.
So all of the data is around oral use of these tablets.
Sure.
Sorry, as the non-medical person in this conversation, you mean ointments?
Yeah, like the Voltaren gel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Voltaren gel.
Yeah.
I think probably there's going to be a degree of systemic absorption.
Yeah.
From it. We're moving into like personal opinion here.
Yeah, of course. Personal opinion.
I wouldn't use it.
Yeah.
I don't think the data is there to support me either way, but I just wouldn't. There's going to be an unpredictable degree of absorption into your system.
Sure.
Even if it's just through the skin. Just steer clear. I mean. Yeah. But keep it simple. Just don't use it. If you do need it, reassess why and if it's the right thing to be doing.
Yep. Okay.
Beautiful.
Number two.
So two is, and this is I know triggers a lot of people, but it's drink to thirst. It's just three words. We keep the whole hydration thing simple. And I'm sure that there's a huge amount of literature about the optimal hydration strategy. And I'm sure we could get a round table of sports physicians and sports doctors together, and there'd probably be a range of opinions. But I think the dominant one and the one that makes the most sense in the context of the New Zealand environment is drink to thirst.
Right.
What that means is, I guess, you can explain what it doesn't mean. So sometimes people might have a schedule that they drink to. Every 15 minutes, I'm going to drink 150 mils of X liquid, water, that sort of thing is proven to run you into trouble. That can lead to either not enough fluid, too much fluid, and problems down the line. If you are guzzling down just water, drinking loads and loads and loads all the time, obsessed about hydrating, which lots of people can be, especially more beginner people, that can also do you harm. Dehydration is the thing that's been pushed to us by the international, drinks industry.
Big soft drink.
big energy drink and all that. But there are other dangers at the other end as well. It's that homeostasis thing. So we can be dry, but we can also end up in a situation where our body starts to hold on to too much water. And just like if you have a pot of soup and you pour more and more water in, you're going to dilute the contents of that soup. And you mentioned we're a tube before. We're kind of like a tube filled with soup in the walls of lots of electrolytes and things. And we need to keep that balanced. And that means what goes into the tube and gets absorbed needs to be about right. So the main problem I'm kind of alluding to there is EAH, or exercise-associated hyponatremia.
Yep.
And to break that down, that's basically in exercise of all durations, but mainly longer, you can run into a hyponatremia, hypo-low natremia sodium. So rather than that being a situation where you've lost loads of sodium, it's more a case of your body's mechanisms for regulating how much water we have and how much we pee out has got confused, mm-hmm. and it's held on to too much water, diluting your sodium, which at the benign end can be asymptomatic and you wouldn't even know, but at the severe end can lead to seizures, coma, water in the lungs, and ultimately people have died of this. So that's why we say drink to thirst rather than drinking too much.
Mm. So that and you help that by taking in not just drinking water, by drinking other fluids, drinking a variety of fluids, and also eating during a race. That also helps. Is that right?
That's right. Yeah. So drink a range of fluids, and if you can, aim to eat. I think the ideal plan for everyone in a ultra distance race, or even something as like an off-road trail race, trail half marathon or something, would be to have a couple of different food options so that you have, we all know we get like different tastes on different days. Some days we want a gel and it's all good, and the next day the thought of it makes us queasy. So I think just have a little bit of redundancy in your food plan so that you've got a couple of options, and try and take that in through the race.
Yeah.
And it's amazing, isn't it? Like when you talk about thirst and when you talk about, when you're exercising, and I can only speak to myself, like sitting there on the couch and going, gosh, I could really kill a cup of tea now, or I'm thirsty. It's a different kind of process, isn't it, to when you're running. You don't kind of get that sort of, I'm actually thirsty, or, you know, I don't get that a lot. But it's almost more of a kind of, if you trust your body, it's almost that primal kind of, it's an unconscious kind of thing. And I think it's the same with, you know, you've all heard stories of crew who, you know, I've got all these things laid out for my runner, and the runner comes in and they've handpicked this incredible A through, you know, L, and all they want is Q, you know, like, because it's quite an instinctual kind of thing, I think, sometimes, isn't it?
And there's no rhyme or reason to it. One race you'll be like, oh, I really enjoy this particular bar. And then the next race you'll be like, I just want some chips or something with like bacon flavor. Like, and it's, you can't predict it. So I think it's good to have your staples, your things that you know that are all right with your body, that are pretty good most of the time. For me, I'm really lucky. Bars sit really well with me. So I always have a couple of different flavors of bar. Sometimes gels don't, so I often take them, but I might not like them. And I've got some good friends who experiment with all sorts of different, like roasted vegetables and that sort of thing, because that's what works for them.
Mm-hmm.
So I think drinking to thirst, taking in a range of fluids, and trying to eat solids as best you can.
Okay.
Hot cups of tea for you, I was one of the...
Yeah. Well, Tarawera, that was, something I just needed, is a nice, sweet, hot cup of tea at Fantastic. One point. It's just, you know, it was, felt like the best thing I'd ever drunk.
Things you crave, eh?
Yeah. One thing, and we're all adults that listen to Dirt Church Radio, so we can talk about this, but urine. Now, I've been running for so long that I've heard different theories on what colour your pee should be and stuff. you know, and you know, what you should be looking out for. Can you just walk us through what we know now, what the science is now around what you should be looking out for, and what the and any danger signs you should be looking out for?
Yeah, sure. So we spend an inordinate amount of time talking about urine we cover ultramarathons, and rightly so. It's useful, and it is also a bit alarming when you go for a pee in the middle of a race and it looks like blood. There's kind of a few things which we can unpack. So the first is like if we talked about like say clear to yellow urine, that is not, it doesn't have a perfect correlation, but it can vaguely reflect your hydration status. If you're peeing clear, you're probably doing all right on the hydration, probably. Not a hard and fast rule by any means. If it's dark and concentrated yellow, either you've had a whole bunch of something which you pee out, like vitamin C can make your urine quite yellow, or maybe you're a bit more on the drier side. Again, you'll know your body from your training runs, you'll know kind of what happens. Then we kind of move into the realm of like rosé to blood. So exercise associated hematuria. So hematuria means hematids, blood, urea is in the urine, is super common in ultra distance running, triathlons as well, but especially in running. The quoted numbers are like 60% plus will have blood on a, we'd get like a dipstick, like you have
right.
Doctors. We put that in there. It might not be visible, but 65% plus of people will have a detectable amount of blood in their urine, which is generally fine. And the vast majority of people that rosé sort of color is as a result of a relatively benign process. So here's the most obvious one is the inside of our bladder is a mucosa, like inside of our mouth. So if it's while you're running, the front and the back are bouncing against each other, they can get like a bit abraded or a little bit raw, and then a little bit of blood can go into your urine. Another way is from foot strike. So our feet are bouncing on the ground the whole time. The blood that's moving through the feet can get damaged, and when it makes it through the kidneys, it kind of leaks out through the foot, so to speak. So you end up with a little bit of blood in your urine from that. And there's even a theory that maybe, and this one I don't know if it, these are all theories, by the way. This one I don't know if it holds as much water, is when we're running, we're kind of shaking our kidneys, and the sieve, it's like shaking a sieve and the sugar gets through, you know,
right.
Like it's more permeable.
Yeah.
That's a reported theoretical mechanism for some blood in urine. But those three methods, those three are all benign. And if you see us at the event, which I mean, we'd encourage you to, if it's worrying you, come and talk to one of the medics or one of the doctors, and we will be able to take a bit of a history, and we'll be able to, the advice will probably be, you should see your doctor for a repeat dipstick of your urine in about 72 hours, because it should have settled down by then. The reason we do that is in a very, very small percentage of people, the bit of blood might be the first sign of something untoward happening with that mucosa inside the bladder.
Right.
So, you know, you see that at the things like a growth on the side of the mucosa or something like that. And we want to catch those things. We don't want to ignore it.
Yeah.
But I'm talking tiny, tiny, tiny minorities, but enough that we should check.
Yeah.
And in terms of the colour, I mean, can you explain, I understand that the amount of, say, if you go from, you know, clear urine or yellow to, and you know, they have the tuttled ones, the pints, if it's a lager versus an IPA, that's the amount of, what they call, it's anti-diuretic hormone, isn't it? It's the amount of hormone that the body's releasing to basically keep things kind of, keep your urine in, keep your water in, eh?
Yeah, so there's a few mechanisms there, because our body works on amount of water volume that's circulating, so like how full the tank is, so to speak, and it also regulates how concentrated our electrolytes are in our blood. So there's actually a couple of different all-of-body regulatory mechanisms that kind of work together to change the flow rate of fluid through our kidneys, and that flow rate through the kidneys is what's important and what's sucked out.
Right.
So there's ADH is antidiuretic hormone is one of them. There's also like our renin-angiotensin aldosterone system, and there's also a whole bunch of systems inside the kidney that do it kind of automatically. Non-steroidals make an appearance here as well. So those are some of the key mechanisms that get broken down by those non-steroidals, but how concentrated our urine is will generally reflect our hydration status, but not always, and it can lead you astray. So it's if you're assessed by one of the doctors that at the finish of one of these races, they'll ask you a load of questions, look at a load of vital signs, and it's about taking a little bit of information from everywhere, because no single thing is going to be predictive of a definite problem. Mm. And there's one last bit of colour of urine I just want to mention as well, and that is like brown, or the teaching is Coca-Cola urine. And that can be a sign of a process called rhabdomyolysis. That's where you get basically a breakdown of your muscles from use and a few other things affect that as well, and release of a substance from the muscle into the blood that then kind of gets into the kidney and out into the urine and kind of damage the kidneys in the process.
So that's proteins going out the kidney, yeah?
Correct, yep. So a protein called myoglobin, which comes out of our muscle and goes, when it's damaged, it gets released into the blood and travels through. And that would give you more of a dark brown, Coca-Cola-y, coffee sort of coloured urine. And that's the one we would really want to hear about. Blood and urine definitely talk to us. We need to give you some advice. This dark brown urine is one we're looking for. And the caveat to all this is I want to be kind of real and thinking, like, most of the time people are peeing in an ultramarathon or an endurance event, it's in like a port-a-loo that's dimly lit.
Yeah.
It's nighttime. And you're like somewhere out the back of Mount Ruapehu and you're not really sure. Think of it in the context of your body. If it looks a bit weird and you don't feel so good, maybe you need to seek help sooner rather than later. If it seems a bit of a strange colour and you feel good, you can maybe reassess things shortly afterwards. But that's kind of that's an overview of urine.
Yep.
That's good. I saw a tweet of a GP the other day. He was talking about beetroot as well. That's something to be careful for.
Yeah.
You have a hoon on the, and I've been caught out that myself. I've obviously got bladder cancer. Oh no, I've just had 4 fresh beetroot the night before. You know, like
absolutely. I think we should. Now you mentioned maybe the pre-race dinners, beetroot should almost be banned.
Yes, that's
it's going to muddy the waters. But the beetroot in urine is completely harmless.
Yeah.
Yeah. Very good. All right. Number 3, is that?
Number three, yep. So number 3 is, again, they're all pretty general, but this one is be prepared for the conditions. So this kind of speaks to a bit of planning ahead. And I think the really literal way to interpret it is to say, is it going to be hot or cold? Have I got all my compulsory gear that I need? Have I actually thought about, are there any other items that I usually take with me above and beyond the compulsory gear that I should have? That's kind of the central part. But then also have a think about the kind of situations you're going to find yourself in this race. Is this a race which involves some navigation, involves you being in like an off-track environment, which some of these races around the country do? Are you prepared for that? Can you get yourself out of trouble if you had to? And also talks about things like, have I done the appropriate training for this event? Have I run all through the night or run in the middle of the night for a miler?
And that's the thing, isn't it? If you come to a race where you're going to need poles and you've just taken them out of the plastic bag at the point of, you know, the day before the race. And we're starting to see that a little bit, aren't we, at the moment? We talked about offline before, you know, and it's said with a fondness, but just the sheer panic of people leading up to a big race on Facebook.
4 weeks out, isn't it?
It's about 4 weeks. I actually had to take myself off the group for about 3 years because I was like you, Tom. I'd be like, no, don't get swept up in it and don't say anything. You know, like it's that sense people just start to, and it's very normal, isn't it? That lose their mind. Yeah, lose their mind. It's like when around taper, right? Taper madness kicks in, and then there's just this like, I don't know what I don't actually like, just yeah, a whole of population delusion.
You feel the weight of your preparation, right? You've been building to this for like 14, 16, 20 weeks or longer, and you're like, if I don't have poles, it's going to ruin me.
Yeah.
But that's the important thing then is to kind of sit back and think, actually, no, like, I'm prepared for the conditions in other ways. Mm. I'm hearing all this chatter about this, but actually, if I look at my own prep, I know that when I run, I actually like to hold on to things when I'm going through the bush, and the race I'm doing actually doesn't have big open climbs that I need poles for, just as an example.
Mm. Yeah.
But I think you can take a lot of knowledge from training events you've done in the build up. Mm. And I think it's important to not throw that out just on race day when you get to the expo and see what everybody else is doing.
Yeah.
You should trust what you've done. If you know that you get a bit colder than other people and you actually want to take a mid layer with you, as well as your jacket and your polypro, and then you hear the night before that actually this particular race has said, oh no, you don't need polypro this time, don't take it out of your bag.
Mm.
Trust that you know yourself.
Yeah.
And you need to do the minimums that the organisers say, but they're just that, they're minimums.
Yeah, they're guides. Yeah, they're guides. Yeah.
Be
yeah.
ready for it. And thinking of ultras in particular, usually there's a system for drop bags, or if it's a loops race, a way to pass back through somewhere. Making sure you've got your other equipment packed when you might need it.
Mm.
So if you know that you are going to be starting in the dark in the morning and it's maybe you'll just need a little bit of a headlight, make sure that you can have that headlight stashed so that you're going to have another one for the nighttime later in the night. And I think that sometimes, you mentioned, people can lose your mind a little bit leading into one of these races. But if you've thought about it, you've done the prep, just think about what works for you and do your thing.
Yeah. And I guess the thing with that too is it's almost that sense also of, and again, you know, it's fully, I say this as like we lepers, not you lepers, right? It's that sense of sometimes you get to the expo and you think, oh, that's a nice bit of kit, or gosh, everyone looks like they've got this bit of bag, or every like. Wow. I've worked at a couple of these things and it's incredible the amount of money people throw down on gear that they're planning to use the next day. You know, and yeah. I think it's that kind of, oh, this is, you know, we all like new stuff, right? And we all kind of, it's that sense, though, of sticking to your prep and swimming in your lane that you've, stuff you've used, nothing new on race day.
That's right. Make sure you meet the minimums of the organisers, but if you have something that works for you, don't change it on the race. It's the old adage of don't wear new shoes on race day.
Yeah, like, absolutely. That
we have so much more gear in endurance sport. It applies to everything, not just the shoes.
Yeah.
And I really like what you say, too, about you've done the training, you know yourself, you know if you suffer from the heat, you know if you suffer from the cold. And we've got a friend, Sean, who, you know, he does suffer in the heat. He does notice, he does get cold and shivery. So he just makes sure that he's got everything there. He's ready and he's prepared. And that's the thing, isn't it? You've done the work, you know yourself, you know what you're preparing for. Back yourself, you've got this.
That's right. And the taper madness is a definite, it's a real phenomenon, I think, in all sports. Maybe even writing things down after your big sessions. That's where training diary is really useful. Use those extra hours you've got free when you've got your legs up on the couch just to look over what you've done and just you might pull some little pearls out of there and you can rest, you can really take confidence and strength from that when you're on race day.
Yeah.
And even acknowledge, I mean, one thing that works for me, you know, as a mental health professional who has some of the, ironically, the most severe bouts of taper madness known to humankind, acknowledging that has been really helpful for me. Like I sort of get to that point and I look forward in my training and I'll plan it out just like this will be peaking here and here I'm going to lose my mind about something, you know, that, you know, why is the cat talking to me in my mother's voice, telling me I'm not good enough? Just actually having that, again, it comes down to awareness, isn't it? And sort of recognizing that it's part of that process.
It sure does.
Yeah.
I think this rule probably leads into number four as well.
Absolutely.
And number four is, this one was one which is born out of our experience at these races. And the this one is, the race doesn't end at the finish line. There's a whole lot of effort and thought that goes into that 50 or 100 into 160 kilometres between the start line and the finish line. But usually that's where the planning stops. People haven't thought, it's just all about getting to the finish line, which is, I totally understand. That's what you're training for. But if you're finishing at, say, 3:30 in the morning and it's kind of chilly, maybe it's rainy a little bit, and you also don't feel $1 million because you've just emptied yourself running 100 miles, you need to have some stuff there. You need to have thought, okay, even if it's just one evening during taper madness to take your mind off the cat that's talking to you, you can think, okay, what am I going to pack for after the finish? And you, I mean, the basic list for me would be you'd want a towel so you can dry off. You'd want some like track pants, maybe a warm like fleece jersey, some shoes or jandals or like sandals that you can put on your feet. Often there's food available, but just a little something that you can drink, maybe a hydration, some sort of hydration liquid or something, maybe just a cold piece of pizza from the night before if that's what you're into, just a backup something. And just put that with a blanket as well, all in a nice bag, and give it to your support crew and say, your job when we're at the finish is to keep this by your side. You must bring this with you everywhere you go. And so that when you come across the finish line, the joy and the elation starts to wear off and you start to realize that you're freezing cold, you can barely stand up and your feet hurt, that you've got something to change into. And we can help look after you, but I've only got so many jackets that I can lend people at 4 a.m. So that one, I must admit, has been grabbed by the community. And a few years ago, we'd say to people, oh, have you got anything with you? And they'd say no. But in recent years, people have been able to say, yeah, I've got the bag right here, which is awesome. And I think people getting out of your wet clothes and having something dry to put on and something to eat means that you can go and enjoy what you've just achieved with your family rather than having to hang out with us in the medical tent, as nice as we are. It's a simple thing to do as well. So you can, I'd almost say that would be, previously in race briefings I've done at various events, I've kind of said that's people's homework the night before the race, but I actually think it would be a better thing to do, say, at the beginning of your taper, where you would normally have a longer run. Just spend an hour just packing your bag or writing a list of what's going to be in there.
I think even stuff like, attending to, thinking about your homeostasis, attending to your hygiene as well, your skin, stuff like that. Even brushing your teeth afterwards, how good is that? You've been eating sports food or pizza or whatever, God knows what else we cram down our food holes when we're running. And then afterwards, I know for me, it's always something that's really helpful just to feel a bit cleaner.
Yeah.
How have you guys found that last hour, that sort of first hour after you've finished long races? Have either of you had an experience which was not so good?
You go. I spent like 15. So I had a really quite a big PB at Kepler, and it had been a hard year. But I looked at the wrong clock coming over the finish line. So I thought I was looking at the Luxmore Grunt clock, thinking, and I turned my watch off for the last at Rainbow Reach or whatever, and I thought I had like some crazy like hour and a half PB, and I went to, not demonstrably, but like I actually went to pieces and had to get stitched back up in the medical tent. They just basically had to put me somewhere warm, and I basically had to sort of come back to my senses. And I think it was sort of accumulation of everything, even though I'd managed everything, and the emotional kind of letdown. And as I was laying there in the medical tent, I was thinking, wait, I was doing the math as I was, as I was feeling better. Yeah. Oh, and I got helicoptered to Invercargill once too.
You did.
But yeah,
that was mid race.
Good ones, eh?
Yeah, you've had some good ones. My ones are quite boring. Number one is I know this happens after most ultras, is I have no appetite. I know that I don't want to eat, and so I know that now, and so I make sure that I've got available some soup or something, just that I can get something in me to get things going. Another thing that happened to me once after the really wet year at Tarawera, what was that? 2018, yeah. And I DNF'd in the 100K, pulled out at Blue Lake. And the second I stopped running, I started shaking and I just couldn't stop. But luckily I had my family with me and got in some warm clothes, had a hot shower when I got back to the motel, had a hot shower. That was one experience, and it was quite, not frightening, but a bit unnerving. I just couldn't stop shaking for hours.
Yeah. We see that. Yeah, that's pretty common, pretty relatively common. We'll get a good few people who do that. And they won't know what's come over them.
No, I couldn't explain it. I was feeling fine, and then suddenly I'm just shaking uncontrollably.
I guess it's that thing, isn't it? You consider the amount of work that you've put in or what you've done, and you've triumphed, but also I don't want to even put this in a negative, but the stress that you've put under your system, your whole system, the stress of running a half marathon for those who, you know, if you run a hard, if you're going for like a, I don't know, 150 or a really hard half marathon.
It depends on what you've,
it depends on what you're
thinking. 5K, 10K, you know.
And it's that thing of finishing the race. And then, yeah, I guess it's that whole of system just kind of adjustment to not doing what you've been doing for 12, 14, 16 hours.
Or even there's
an emotional intensity that comes with it as well. It's a physical effort, and then you have this massive emotional release, and your body's madly trying to maintain homeostasis in the background, and it often falls to pieces. So any extra aids that we can bring in to help that body wrap it up in something warm, have some soup and some comfort food. Not everyone has the luxury of having family there, so having a thought out way of getting home. I'm sure if Uber is in all of the locations that we have races around the country, so Uber may work in some places, but do your research basically on that as well.
Yeah.
That's what's needed to help the body just ease back into equilibrium.
Yeah. Can I just extend that point that you just made about getting home? Is that important plan of what are you going to do after the race? How are you going to get home? What are you going to do? I spoke to Dr. Marty Hoffman last year, who's a world authority, really, on
guru on
endurance and you know what happens to your body. And I said to him, you know, what's the most dangerous thing about these endurance events? He said, oh, driving home. We get so many people either get seriously injured or die in traffic accidents because they finish a race, they're tired, they're depleted, and they drive home.
Because they're euphoric as well.
Yeah, and they drive home and then bang, you know, they fall asleep or something happens. They're not themselves. So that's another important thing to remember is what are you going to do to get home or back to your accommodation or, you know, how are you going to keep safe?
100%. Definitely would 100% support that. And it's, you got to enjoy the thing that you've done. If you're trying to squeeze it in around a whole of other commitments, it's all good. But just take an extra half day. So get a night's accommodation and enjoy it.
Yeah.
And especially, I guess, as well, if we think about, I remember I nearly threw up in an Uber at the end of W2K because we did actually get an Uber.
We did.
And we had warm clothes, we had food, we were doing everything right. We had a group of us together, you know, it was great. And suddenly I was sitting in the front seat of this Toyota Prius heading down Lambton Quay and just got this wave of cramp and nausea. I was like, I'm going to hurl in this dude. I'm going to throw up in this man's Uber. Oh, that was – don't ever do what I do, anyone. Just and it passed, right? I just had that moment of panic, that cold sweat.
He's probably seen it before.
Not at 3 in the afternoon with a dude with 3-inch split shorts on. Or maybe he has, but it's
– it's Wellington. Anything's possible. Yeah.
Oh, and what was I was going to say as well, in terms of the connection, and we think about the whole thing about – especially in the current climate – you know, we've all been disciplined. We're reaping the rewards of being able to come together and do these events. If you're going down to Tarawera or Kepler or Wutuke or anywhere like that, I mean, I'm sure some motelier would really appreciate, or your mate staying an extra half day and buying some groceries or contributing and just going to the park or putting back into that kind of economy as well. Hey,
totally. Yeah. Especially this year.
I like number
five. Which leads to number five, really, as well.
So number five is one which I think pretty much every race briefing I've been to from when I was a young teenager, the organisers have said this in one way or the other, and that's look out for each other. Competitors are the most valuable resource out there from a medical response perspective. We have, in a big race, you might have 1,000 runners, and that's 1,000 sets of eyes out there on course looking for people who might be in trouble. And it's, we're not expecting everyone to be able to administer medical care themselves, but just being able to say hi to a fellow runner or just notice that someone doesn't seem right and check in with them, especially when you're getting up at these events which go all night. And the sleep deprivation starts to become an issue, people can end up in some pretty odd places. The one that strikes me the most was a couple of years ago, I ran Revenant in the first year that it was on. And I did it as a duo with a good mate. And we were making our way up the Nohomai stream. And we were on our second time through, and we saw a light that we came up upon, and it was a guy, don't know who it was, I think he was from overseas, but he looked like a man possessed. He was by himself. He had his headlight off his head. He looked like he had the fear of God in him as we came upon him. And we just said hello, and turned out he was all right. He was seeing some pretty weird things, but he'd been up for the better part of 24 hours and was by himself trying to navigate through this pretty tricky bit of forest. Wow. And then he'd just seen these two sort of weird white lights sort of come out of the middle of nowhere. So he'd had a pretty trippy experience, and all we did was just check in and say hi, and that was all that was needed. He seemed all right. He wasn't in trouble. He was just a bit seeing some funny things. And he carried on, and he was okay. But you will see people who run into issues like that in some of these milers and ultras.
Yep.
And the risk is that people make really bad decisions.
Yeah. Yeah.
You might have the most well-labeled course marking or the easiest looking bit of track, but if you are that out of it, you might not really even be able to decide which way to go at this track junction.
Yeah.
Well, especially, I mean, that's the thing, isn't it? And I was going to use the word tripping balls, but also if your reality is being tested that strongly, like if you are hallucinating, if you're suffering from, you know, visual, tactile, auditory hallucinations at that point, because again, you know, for whatever reason, sleep deprivation or exertion or whatever, it's a pretty scary place for people, hey?
Totally. And it's you're struggling to hold on to reality.
Mm.
How on earth are you supposed to remember to eat and drink and
yeah,
to
absolutely.
Replace, move those things around in your pack and change your batteries on your light and things like that. So I full credit to anyone who manages to race that revenant on their own for the entire time.
Mm.
My background's kind of a bit more in adventure racing lately, and the teammates are what you get a lot of strength from. In an ultra, we hear every year of stories of people who have like kind of teamed up with various sections of courses.
Yep.
Just to kind of have someone to talk to, someone to keep an eye on them, and it's kind of mutually beneficial. You have an extra mind, and if you're running at 50% mental capacity, but you've got some kind of a mind between the two of you,
yep.
So you can kind of be safer and work together to get to the finish. Plus, yeah. I think it's some pretty cool friendships.
Absolutely. Yeah. What were we trying to do in the last couple of Ks of W2K we ran together for the whole way? What we were trying to work out Jared Hayden's Western split.
We were trying to talk about 50% mental capacity for Western States, and it was just impossible to do.
Yeah, Jared Hayden. We were trying to work out his. We're trying to convert it into miles and kilometers. And
there's some high level maths to do. An ultra.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it was ridiculous. Yeah. And even both of us, we were just making it worse for each other.
But just on Western Okataina last year at Tarawera. I picked up a pacer, so I was really lucky. My good friend Gene, who I'm pacing for this year, but he and I set off, and by the end, we had four of us traveling together because someone else, a listener, shout out to you, joined in with us, and then we saw another competitor who we know. We came across him. He was kind of in a precarious position trying to have a sleep on the track, and we checked on him and just said, "Are you okay?" And he ended up jumping up and coming. Well, first of all, we jumped up and took off, but then we came across him again, sort of equally precarious, and said, "Are you okay?" And he ended up coming with us. And so we had this sort of band of four moving through the night. You just look out for each other, make sure everyone's okay.
It's like a pain train, isn't it?
Thank you.
That's perfect. That's exactly what we'd like people to do. And, you know, true adventures are shared.
So absolutely.
You have a buddy to, like, recount stories with the following day, and
absolutely.
And that's what people remember, isn't it? They don't remember, well, I mean, of course you do if you know some people do remember their splits, but you remember that shared discussion or that chat or that view that you got to engage with someone who's instantly kind of your best friend.
Absolutely. Hey Tom, so that top five is fantastic, and if you're happy that we've covered everything off, you mentioned your own bit of your own experience there, but you know you've raced at world championship level for orienteering and adventure racing, haven't you?
A few years ago now, but I have my background is kind of in mountain biking and orienteering, and then kind of merged into some trail running at like the kind of goat kind of goat coated run, that sort of distance.
Right.
And then in the last sort of 5-10 years, expedition length adventure racing has probably been the main thing that I've done. So things like Godzone and XPD and those sort of things.
Wow.
Yeah, but I think orienteering probably is my like true passion. And I think orienteering there's a across the country there's a lot of people who you wouldn't realise in ultra but also trail circles who have a background in orienteering, and I think it prepares you super well because you get good at running off road, you get confident training in the backcountry because you can read maps, and you also you get a bit of a workout if you're going cross country during an orienteering.
And I guess it's got to, and I think about people like, I mean, two who spring to, I mean, there's yourself, there's Gene Beveridge, there's Dennis DeMonkey, I think about Hanny Alliston from Australia, and Sean Collins, of course, and his wife Madeline and his girls. Does it give you that sense also of, I mean, it is the equivalent orienteering, isn't it, of trying to work out Jared Hazen's, trying to work out his splits while you're running as fast as you can across. So it gives you, I guess it's that thing, isn't it? It gives you your mental, that plasticity of your mind as well, hey, works.
Absolutely,
the mind.
Yeah. It's a good way to reimagine a place where you always run. You can, I mean, orienteering, we use maps again and again, but the courses are always different. And you can do like a normal run, like Woodhill Forest is a good example. You can run on the roads or run on the tracks, but pretty soon you can feel pretty familiar. Chuck some orienteering controls out there and you've got a whole new world to explore while running. So it's cool like that too.
And I guess transposing that too, you know, you mentioned the Revenant, it was this weekend, and our friend Ian Evans taking it out and being out there, like you said, you know, he was out there by himself for a long time.
A long time.
I mean, that's orienteering on steroids, isn't it?
Yeah, it's got an interesting, because you if you're new, it's a bit of orienteering. If you've done it before, you kind of have a bit of a sense of where you're going.
Right.
So that first time round, and if you're not that great with directions or recognising things, maybe a second time round as well. But yeah, it's kind of a different take on like the long distance orienteering or a Rogaine. I don't know how he was. I kind of saw snippets of what's happened over the last few days, and I full credit to him for that long on his own.
Yeah, he was the only one to go out on lap 4.
Yeah. Remarkable.
Extraordinary. Yeah.
Remarkable. He's one of the most, I mean, he is one of the most level human beings I've ever met. You know, what you see and his smile on his face is just sort of never leaves his face. He's like that all the time. You know? Yeah. So, fantastic.
Where did your medical interest come from? Is that something you'd always wanted to be or, you know, how did that come about?
No, not really. I towards the end of school, I maybe fell into it a little bit and it seemed I really enjoyed lots of sport, so it kind of was a physical biology and human biology was a good extension of that. And then I've just kind of jumped on the conveyor belt, and on the way through had a range of different interests, but have been lucky to meet some doctors along the way who've helped to shape the way to go. One especially is Ben McHale, who I do lots of this medical coverage with. I met him as a medical student and he was a junior doctor and made a big impression, and he actually started covering a lot of these events before I did. And then I've kind of got to be a part of the coverage through him. And along the way also realised that actually the part of sports medicine that I enjoy is the acute urgent stuff, like the emergency things,
right,
which is kind of what you need to be ready for at an event like Tarawera. So yeah, that's kind of how I've got there.
Fantastic. Well, look, Tom, I mean, not to break down the fourth wall, but we know you've got a night shift to get to, and I understand, you know, it's 1 of 4, so that's a journey, that's an ultra in itself. Before we let you go, we ask the same question of everyone who comes on Dirt Church Radio, and that's, hey, Dr. Tom Reynolds, what is your greatest run ever?
Well, I was actually out very close to where this run happened today. And it was when I was first started as a doctor, working up in Whangarei with a mate, and we kind of set out with like a loose idea for a loop that we thought we might be able to do. Maybe there were some tracks on the map. Maybe we could get around the coast. And basically it was a loop from Whananaki up to a place called Mimi Whangata and then back around through the bush, which we estimated was about 20-something kilometres. And people who might have run with me would know I'm terrible, despite the orienteering, terrible at this estimation. So when we got to about 30 Ks and we were still like nowhere near the finish, the run had deteriorated into a bit of an epic kind of survival game. We eventually made it back up to like 44 or 45 Ks, but we got to take in some amazing bit of coast that we got to run around. We were climbing up cliffs and running on the rock platforms. There's some beautiful tracks up near Mimifangata, some trails up through natives. And then just that kind of shared sense of accomplishment when we got back finally to the cars and could feel like we'd survived something. That would probably be one of my most memorable runs ever.
Fantastic. I'm actually going up to Mimifangata this weekend, so I might tap you after this is finished for any tips you have on some trail running.
Cause there's a track up the back there that's not marked on the map, but it's a very, very nice connection through to Whanganui.
Oh, nice.
Fantastic.
What was the total, how long were you out for in the end?
Oh, we were out for like the better part of 6 hours, I think.
Oh.
And we'd vastly undercated as well. So like we didn't take bags. We had like maybe shoved a couple of gels in our shorts and we're drinking out of streams and all that sort of thing. It was getting pretty desperate towards the end.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Hey, look, Tom, thank you so much. Be safe, enjoy your shift, and we'll both look forward to seeing you at Tarawera in a couple of weeks.
Sounds good. Thanks. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for coming on.
Thanks, Tom. Boy, between us, we really do have some good after-race stories,
don't we?
Mainly
me.
No, I've got some good ones.
You've got some good ones.
Yeah.
You've got some good ones. Yeah. You've got some really good ones.
I didn't tell all the ones where I went, "That's it, I'm never running again." Because I didn't think they counted as medical issues.
Well, they kind of do, but...
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Anyway,
fantastic. Tom, hope you learned something.
Yep, Dr. Tom is the man, and we're stoked we're going to get to catch up with him at Tarawera in a couple of weeks and hopefully catch up with lots of you. But until then, thank you very much for tuning in. We're on social media at Dirt Church Radio. You can email us at dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. You can find us on iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, and other podcast platforms, and you can download direct from the website, which is dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. And if we're not where you want us to be, let us know. Don't forget to subscribe, rate us. If you like what you see, spread the love. It would be great as many people heard the show as possible. And for that, we need your help.
Don't forget to send in your greatest run ever, and you can read them on the website too. People love doing that, and we love hearing from you with them.
Thanks to our sponsors, Scott Running, Further Faster, Spring Energy, and CLE. And thank you to our Patreon patrons and Wild Things. Thank you to our editor, Kieran. We've got a great guest lined up next week, so tune in then. Ka kite.
We're crashing to an end. Ka kite.
Thanks, Rigby.